everyone for coming. We always are going to have issues if it's going to be virtual, but to get started, a quick introduction. Dr. Hugh Lewis is a professor of astronautics and the head of the Astronautics Research Group at the University of Southampton. He has worked in the field of space debris and space sustainability for more than 20 years and is the author of the Damaged Space Debris Model. He represents the UK Space Agency at meetings of the Interagency Space Debris Coordination Committee, where he chairs Working Group 2, which is focused on space debris modeling. Hugh has also represented the UK Space Agency at scientific and technical subcommittee meetings as the United Nations Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. Thank you so much for being here. Go ahead and get started. Thank you.
Many thanks, Emma. Also, many thanks for the invitation to talk to you today. I'm coming to you from evening here in the UK. I'm dressed informally, so I hope that's okay with you. As Emma said, I'm talking about space debris and space sustainability today. I've been working in this area for a long time, but actually there's still a lot to learn about it. And in fact, this talk, putting this talk together, was actually a really good opportunity for me to learn even more about what it is I've been doing for the last 20 years and trying to put it into some context. So I'm going to be going through some explanations of space debris and space sustainability, but I'm going to use some rather perhaps unusual ways of doing that. I have a preference for using things like movie stills and imagery to represent the concepts that we're talking about. Now, as we're on YouTube, I've had to be very careful about the intellectual property of many of the images I'm using. So I've been very carefully scouring the internet for images where I can actually use them and also give credit to the authors. So you'll have to forgive me. Some of the images are rather more artistic and conceptual than perhaps I'm more used to, but I'm sure you'll get it. So perhaps even if you're not necessarily paying attention to what I'm talking about, one thing you can do is to try and guess the movie reference as we go through the talk. So I'm going to start off with hopefully a relatively easy one for you. And I'll help you out with this one. So this is obviously a representation of a scene in the film Gravity. Now, Gravity was released back in 2013, I think, and obviously represented a really mainstream effort to talk about and explain space debris and some of the space debris issues. Now, it's thanks to this particular movie that my job has become much easier in terms of explaining what space debris is and what the issues are that we face with respect to space debris. In particular, the film really did portray a human element to the space debris problem. And in fact, this is where I'm going to start to try and challenge your thinking to do with space debris. And a lot of the talk is about misconceptions about space debris and actually what the truth actually is. So for those of you perhaps hadn't really thought about this in any great depth at all, the film Gravity is actually a horror movie. And I can explain in the sense that if you're also familiar with another movie which starred Sigourney Weaver, very early 80s movie, the reflection in the helmet there might give you a clue. If you think about the film that Sigourney Weaver starred in and the film Gravity starring Sandra Bullock, you'll probably be surprised to learn that the plot lines are actually very similar. And in the case of Gravity, if you replace the space debris with an alien, you end up with a very similar plot. Hence, my belief that Gravity is actually a horror movie. And in fact, you know, when you think about the problem, when you think about how much we're using space and how much we need satellites and so on for our everyday services, you start to see that it is actually a real domain for horror, in the sense that if we lose the satellites, if we lose those services and the data that we rely on to tell us about the Earth, then we are literally in a bit of a horror story. So that's the first kind of thing I just wanted to try and shake up. But what I'll do now is just to explain exactly what I'm talking about. So space debris, here's a definition that actually comes from the agency that, sorry, the committee that I'm a part of. And the definition of space debris, all human-made objects that include fragments, anything else that are in Earth orbit or even re-entering the atmosphere that are non-functional. Now, even that definition is actually problematic because who gets to decide what a suitable function is or whether something is actually non-functional? I've learned in my research that actually in the US, the what are now called the Guardians at the US Space Force actually trained on derelict objects in terms of understanding how orbital motion works and you know, cataloging those objects. So they're derelict objects that are actually providing some kind of function, a training function. So could we argue that they're not actually space debris? Well, I think most people would say that they still are. So I think you know, the definition is okay for us to continue to use. And that's the one that I'm going to stick with throughout the talk. Now, in terms of the population of space debris that are in orbit at the moment, we can see on this graph, which has come from data that have been collected by the website Celestrac, that we've actually catalogued a rather large number of objects, about 50,000 objects since the beginning of the space age, of which about half are still in orbit now. So this catalogue doesn't necessarily represent all of the objects that are in orbit, because some objects are not put into the public catalogue because of their classified missions, for example, or because we're not able to pick them up on a subsequent orbital pass. So these numbers don't actually represent the full population of space debris and objects that are in orbit. Now, in terms of the objects that are in orbit, we have over, I think it's about 4,500 objects that are actually active satellites, of which a huge proportion of those will be from the Starlink constellation. And what's interesting from this graph is actually you can see since, in the last 10 years that we've had quite a steady growth of the catalogue and the number of satellites that are in orbit. So we really are seeing quite a substantial growth of the orbital population, very recently, thanks to commercialization of space and so on. Now, I mentioned that the catalogue is not complete, and the European Space Agency estimates that there are, in fact, around about 36,500 objects that are trackable in size. So these are about the size of a softball or larger, so about 10 centimetres in size or larger than that, which is a really large number. But that number is actually dwarfed when you start to look at the number of objects that are smaller than that in Earth orbit. So when you look at a marble, so it's about the size of a thumbnail, then ESA estimate there to be about 1 million objects that are between that size and the size of a softball. When you get down to the size of 1 millimeter ball bearing, which is the same size as the ball bearing in the end of a ballpoint pen, then ESA are estimating about 330 million of those in orbit at the moment. So the numbers are actually huge. And if I told you that every single one of those objects can cause problems for satellites, certainly at the larger end of the object size there, could cause a catastrophic breakup of a satellite. But even down at the smaller end, something, 1 millimeter in size, if it hits in the right place with a satellite that doesn't have much structure in the way, then you can still disable a satellite with something the size of a millimeter. So all these objects represent a problem for the satellites that we have in orbit at the moment. In fact, one of the biggest concerns that we have in the space debris or orbital debris community are these collisions that can occur. Now, we have seen collisions occur in orbit, and here's an example of one that took place earlier on this year. It's an impact onto one of the robotic arms on the International Space Station. And the image on the left there, you can see the hole that was punched through the cloth exterior for the arm. And there you can see on the right-hand side that arm in context on the space station. So that didn't prevent the arm from working, but it is a reminder, obviously a very obvious reminder to the astronauts on the International Space Station that what they're doing actually exposes them to this orbital debris risk, very much like the film Gravity portrayed. But this kind of impact, as I say, doesn't really leave us with any lingering problems. But we have seen much more substantial collisions taking place in the orbital environment in not necessarily recent years, but in relatively recent years. So this graphic represents the consequences of a collision that took place in February 2009, involving at the time an active satellite, part of the Iridium constellation. So that satellite was involved in a collision with an old derelict Russian military satellite, Cosmos 2251. The two satellites collided over Siberia just under 12 kilometers per second. Now, to put that speed into context, that's the same as me going from London to New York in probably around about 10 minutes. So the speed is, the relative speed was enormous. That produced two very large debris clouds, which then expanded, wrapped around the Earth several times. And most of that debris is still in orbit today and causing continuing problems for the satellites that are there. So this type of collision is obviously very concerning for us in the space debris community and obviously for satellite operators. It's exactly this type of collision that we want to try and prevent. And the ways in which we can do that are through space debris mitigation guidelines. These are not enforceable in any sense, but often what happens is that the member states of the United Nations, they adopt these debris mitigation guidelines, they put them into their regulations, for example. And I won't go through these in detail, just perhaps to say that the first five really are about preventing the creation of new debris in the short term, and the bottom two there are about preventing orbital debris in the long term, so these major collisions. And all of these mitigation measures that operators can take will have an impact upon the mission. Whether it's additional propellant that's required to deorbit the spacecraft, whether it's increasing technology to provide a discharge for the batteries to remove any excess propellant. All of them have an impact. And of course, that then means that there's a trade-off, because some operators might find it very difficult to implement these, and that might mean that their spacecraft poses an increased risk in the environment. However, these guidelines really have been the guiding principles for operations in certainly in low Earth orbit and geostationary orbit for quite some time now. And we continue to look for these in terms of the regulation of any upcoming space missions. Now, I can't really talk about space debris without mentioning Don Kessler. So some of you may have heard of something known as the Kessler syndrome, which is named after Don Kessler. So Don was actually the chief scientist at NASA's Orbital Debris Program Office for some years, and was instrumental, in fact, in setting up that office. Previously, he'd worked in the Environmental Effects Project Office there at NASA. And Don, with colleagues at NASA, they conducted some studies looking at the space debris population and their expectations for the future. And there's a really important paper that was published back in 1978, so a very long time ago now, which really did warn the community about what would happen if we didn't take any steps to try and prevent the space debris population from growing. And it was really stark warning, in the sense that we'd end up with a debris ring around the Earth that could prevent access to space. So it was a real driver for the space debris mitigation guidelines that I've just talked about. But there's a really big problem with how the Kessler syndrome has been portrayed in the media and even in some scientific articles. There are a lot of misconceptions that are around, which can potentially lead us down the wrong path in terms of addressing the space debris problem. So I wanted to just talk about some of those for you now. So it's really about misconceptions. Now, again, using a movie still here, hopefully, or an image from a movie, you'd recognize the film. If you don't, just think about this as an example of something that we believe to be true, but is actually not true. And maybe we learn about it later on. Hopefully we can change our thinking, but in many senses, what we're seeing in the media, this portrayal of the Kessler syndrome, people continue to repeat these kind of misconceptions around the Kessler syndrome. So let's take a look at that. So perhaps one of the first and most obvious problems that arise with respect to understanding the Kessler syndrome, and it was effectively portrayed in the film Gravity, that is that Kessler syndrome is something that happens very quickly. So in Gravity, the film lasted just over 90 minutes, and we saw pretty much the destruction of all the satellites in low Earth orbit in that time. Now, in reality, the Kessler syndrome wouldn't happen that quickly. 90 minutes is about the time it takes for the International Space Station to make one revolution of the planet. So any debris wouldn't have even spread out in the time of the movie took place. So, you know, that's a really obvious kind of misrepresentation, misconception about debris, that it would about the Kessler syndrome, that it would happen that quickly. The other thinking about it is that once it starts, it will be unstoppable. And that's not true either. All we'd need to do is to go up and start to remove some of the larger objects from orbit, prevent those objects and the mass involved in those objects from being fragmented, basically, so we could stop it. Another misconception is that the debris would prevent this impenetrable barrier around the Earth. Well, space is really, really big. And there aren't enough objects really to prevent us from actually accessing space. Now, it would pose a risk, and we're already starting to see the fact that whenever we launch a rocket now, we have to kind of thread our way through objects that are in orbit. And those are small changes to the launch times, for example, just to make sure that we do miss these objects. So it is starting to happen, but it's not this impenetrable barrier. Another thinking is that there is this chain reaction that occurs. So, you know, two objects collide, then the fragments from those then go on and collide, introducing more fragments into the environment and so on. You get this very rapid exponential growth. And that's not really the problem we're worried about. The reality is that we can put one object into the environment, and that object is going to create maybe an additional one object. And if every object does that, then we end up with this still an exponential growth in the population. So that's a more insidious growth of the population rather than this kind of chain reaction that was so often talked about. And there are a few other misconceptions as well that arise around the Kessler syndrome, but those are the kind of main ones. Apart from the fact that many people believe that this process, this Kessler syndrome, has not yet begun and that we can still prevent it from happening. And the truth around that is a little bit different. The truth is actually that this process did start, but perhaps back in the 1980s, and we're already starting to see the consequences of that. So, and I'll show you why I think that's true in just a moment. So the way in which we look at this problem here in Southampton is we build computational models of the orbital debris population and the environment that population is in. And then we run simulations to help us to understand how that population is going to evolve into the future. So a model here is just a conceptual tool, an idea that explains how an object or a system of objects is going to behave. In our case, it's the space debris population that we're looking at. Now, what I wanted to do is just show you how we what the typical issues are with modeling. That helps us to understand why we have yet to really solve the space debris problem and why we perhaps still don't know what's going to happen next. First thing is what do we simulate? So here, here's a starling. Okay, so this is a single starling, and I could build a computational model of a starling, you know, all of its characteristics, wings, beak, eyes, and so on. But is that really what I want to do? Because I can also take a whole population of starlings, and I can understand then how they interact and the patterns that form collectively. And then the question is, do I need to have a model of the beak, the wings, the body, and so on, in order to understand this rather more perhaps beautiful and complex interaction between the starlings? This is a murmuration that took place very close to me, actually, just a few miles away. So you can see, you know, we have to understand what it is that we're trying to model. And this perhaps graphic helps us to understand. We need to perhaps take the simplest model that explains or conceptualizes the thing that we're looking at. So here I've got a range of different complexities of a house. The one right on the left, it's so simple, you could mistake that for an arrow rather than a house, and therefore perhaps the complexity isn't high enough. But then as we progress through, we can see different things are added in to help us understand that it is a house. We can get to the right-hand side here, and we can see lots of complexity added in: windows, chimneys, doors, the roof, so much more complex. And then finally, we can get to the stage where, you know, we can add in the materials, the colors, and so on. The problem with getting to a model that's that complex is that we lose the transparency. We lose the ability to understand what's going on and to interrogate the model. So actually what we want to try and do is take the simplest model that we can that explains the phenomenon that we're looking at. And that's really, really important, because I can now kind of take you through some of the ideas to do with modeling and what we can learn from it. But before I do that, I just want to talk about one thing. One of the most important things that we use for models are predictions. Now, it's really easy to think when we make predictions that we're saying this is what the future will look like. I'm using this example from, I'll tell you what this movie is. This is from Blade Runner. So Blade Runner was filmed in the early 1980s, and it was released in 1982, but it was set in the year 2019. And if you think back to the year 2019, not too far ago, we didn't have flying cars. We didn't have replicants, such as the one played by Rutger Hauer here. That the prediction that was made back in the 1980s, you know, didn't turn out to be true. But actually, back in the 1980s, it probably did represent a plausible future. It did represent something that could have come to pass. And that's what we're trying to do with our modeling. It's just trying to produce a plausible future so we can understand and answer some questions that are important to us. But there's something else about prediction that is really important to take away. Whenever we make a prediction, that can actually affect the future, because we make a prediction about the orbital debris population. And for example, from that, we learn that we need to take some steps to stop the growth of the orbital debris population. So in the present, we introduce some new orbital debris mitigation measures, and that changes what the future looks like. So just by predicting it doesn't mean to say that is actually what's going to happen. We actually change the future because of the predictions that we make. And that's a really difficult concept to try and capture when we do these models and when we produce the results. So I want to talk to you about a simple model of the orbital debris population. Use a natural population to start off with. So penguins as example, bacteria, another example as well. There's going to be some maths. I'm going to take you through it really, really quickly. But don't worry, hopefully it's all relatively easily understood. So let's look at how a natural population might grow. So we can use a very simple model. to understand the growth of a single population, penguins, bacteria, and so on. And that's known as an exponential model. Okay, so I've got the mathematics for an exponential model on the screen here. So basically, on the left-hand side, you can see N, and that's the number of items in the population. So here, penguins. On the right-hand side of that equal sign, we've got capital R raised to the power T, where T is time. Okay, and then we've got the number of items in the population at the beginning. So this equation basically tells me what any future population is going to look like, and it's based upon what the initial population is, and then this value R raised to the power T. So R is actually a growth rate. And what we see is if R is bigger than one, then the population will grow. If R is less than one, the population will decline. Very, very similar to the growth of the COVID pandemic and the R rates that are used. It's not quite the same, but it's the same kind of principle that we can use. So this is a graph that shows you exponential growth for just some imaginary population. I can write down that exponential model in a slightly different way using a differential equation. So the differential equation is shown at the bottom. It features something very similar. Another growth rate now in this case is a lowercase r. So it's a very, very simple model. But when we start to look at real natural populations, what we find is that actually as the population grows, there's something that actually starts to inhibit the population growth. And that is the fact that we start to consume more resources. And actually that slows down the population growth. So we can include that into this very simple model. And we see how the kind of graph changes now. We still have this initial exponential growth phase, but then it kind of flattens out and reaches this equilibrium point. And this is a really important model. This is known as logistic population model. And it's important because it allows us to define something known as a carrying capacity. It's the kind of maximum population size that the resources, the land might support. And natural populations follow this rule. Even the human population follows this rule. But the same is not true for the space debris population, because the more objects I put into the same area, the more likely it is that they would hit and create even more objects. So we see this opposite effect for space debris. And when we put that into this exponential model, what we find is instead of having this kind of simple exponential model, we have something that can be referred to as a super exponential model. It grows very rapidly. You can see that on the graph on the right-hand side. Now we have one kind of saving grace in terms of the orbital debris population, and that is the Earth's atmosphere. Okay, the atmosphere extends quite high up in terms of altitude, and satellites, as they're flying through, because they're traveling so quickly, the drag force that acts on the satellites removes energy from the orbit, and those satellites eventually decay downwards and burn up in the atmosphere. So that's a mechanism we have for potentially controlling the growth of the population. This atmosphere, you can see is an image taken from the ISS here, looking at the Earth limb. The atmosphere is actually really thin, compared to the size of the Earth. But as I say, it does extend upwards to where the satellites are traveling. The problem is that as we go up higher in altitude, the atmosphere gets less and less dense. And what that means is that the satellites don't decay as quickly as a result of the atmospheric drag. So this graph is showing you a typical lifetime. This is the orbital lifetime of an object that is of a fairly standard size, but depending on the altitude. So if I take an altitude of around about 600 kilometers here, you can see just by following the graph that the expected orbital lifetime is around about 10 years. So if we abandon something at the altitude of 600 kilometers, 10 years later, it would burn up in the atmosphere, perhaps on average. But as we go up in altitude, the effect of the atmosphere just get that much weaker. And if we go up to an altitude of around about 1,300 kilometres, what we see is that the expected lifetime is about 10,000 years. If we're at an altitude of 2,000 kilometres, the expected lifetime is about 100,000 years. So it turns out that the atmosphere just and the space environment just doesn't forget. It kind of holds on to the objects. Even if we forget it, the orbital environment doesn't. And that's a really big problem for our exponential growth model, because if we go up high enough, it's almost as if there's no atmosphere. The atmosphere has no effect. And that is the only mechanism we have for removing objects from the orbital environment. So it turns out, if we go back and revisit the misconceptions around the Kessler syndrome, is that there's no tipping point. And that's a common expectation, you know, that there's something that we can point to that says at that point, that's when the Kessler syndrome started. Well, actually the population doesn't behave in that way. We get this smooth growth. The exponential growth can start off even if we have a really low population. It turns out we can start off this exponential growth with just a handful of objects. So there's no kind of sense of a chain reaction either. The other thing, if you look at the graph on the right-hand side, the growth can be slow at the beginning. It's almost flat, it's almost linear. And then very suddenly we get this very sudden uptick in the growth rate. So this is what the very simple model tells us about the orbital debris population. And we can use this now to start to understand some really important concepts. Before I do that, I just introduce the concept of space sustainability. It's actually quite a weak definition, because it tells us about how we should behave in space. We need to preserve the environment for future generations. It doesn't really tell us how we do that. And that's a bit of a problem. But this concept of space sustainability really did grow out of the concept of sustainability in our Earth, our terrestrial environment. So we can use some of the ideas from that to think about space debris and sustainability. So for example, a carbon footprint, we can think about now a space debris footprint. And the way we can do that is by looking at the exponential model and the growth rate, for example, that the population demonstrates. So here is looking back at the existing population in orbit and looking back at the last 20 years of our space activity and fitting an exponential model to that, and then taking the growth rate, and we get like an R value. We can get an annual growth rate, and we can look at the population doubling time. So those in a sense represent our footprint in the orbital environment. We can think about things like a carrying capacity. Now, I've talked about a carrying capacity in terms of a natural population, didn't really think about it in terms of a debris population. Now, we can define it more or less if we make sure that we've included the atmosphere. And with our very simple model, we can end up with curves that look like this, which show us how many objects that we can have in our population at different altitudes, and this is for low Earth orbit. So I take, for example, an altitude of 600 kilometers, then the capacity for objects that are about 1 square meter in size is about 10,000. If I go up in altitude, what I find is that capacity starts to come down. And in fact, it gets very low, you know, so I can exceed the capacity by putting in, you know, about 10 objects at an altitude of about 1,700 kilometers. Now, another way to think about capacity is kind of to invert it a little bit. We see this with respect to the Earth overshoot day. What day of the year do we consume more resources than the Earth can actually provide for our population size, the human population size? And here's a graphic from the overshoot day organization showing you how that overshoot day has occurred earlier and earlier in the year. Through time. Now we can do something very similar for the space debris population by considering the orbital capacity and understanding whether or not we've gone over that capacity. And it turns out that up to altitudes around about 550 kilometers, we're doing okay. Above that altitude, we've probably exceeded the orbital capacity. So we're in this overshoot situation. And that's obviously a very worrying sign that we have already put too many things into the orbital environment, and the orbital environment cannot sustain that population of debris. So, you know, things like this, looking back at the footprint, looking back at the things like an overshoot, help us to really convey ideas about the orbital debris population really quite simply and so on. And this has come, as I said, from a very simple model, an exponential growth model for the orbital debris population. So, you know, we can actually learn a lot from very simple models. We don't necessarily need the complicated models either. So I've just said that we don't need the complicated models, but actually what happens if we do use a complicated model? Can we, you know, do we see the same kind of things, for example? Well, what I'm going to show you next, and very briefly, I understand, is I'm taking a different journey. I'm going to be using or showing you results from the space debris model that we developed here at Southampton, which is simulates every single object in the environment that is trackable. It simulates the launch activities, simulates the collisions that take place, and generates the fragments from those. So it's like modeling the starling and also the murmuration of the starlings as well inside this model. So it takes a long time to run compared to our exponential model, and it gives us different insights that we can use. But here I'm going to use it to see if we get the same answers as the simple model. So I'm going to show you here. Here's a graphic which shows you the output from our debris model, our evolutionary debris model. It's called damage. And this is a chart which shows you the change in the population as a function of the year. So we've simulated in this case a 200 year future projection. So remember what I said about a prediction? We're not saying this is exactly what we're expecting to happen in 200 years. It's a plausible look at what the future might hold if we continue with current space activity on top of implementing the space debris mitigation guidelines that I talked about earlier on in the talk. So this is, if you like, an optimistic view of the future. We're launching things that we've been launching recently, that's including the simulation, but we're really tightly controlling the growth of the debris population by imposing these United Nations space debris mitigation guidelines. So just to take you through very quickly what we're seeing, the orange line at the bottom there is just the number of new fragments, the blue line, the number of intact objects. So these would be things like spacecraft and rocket bodies that haven't been involved in explosions or collisions. The green line represents the fragments that were in orbit in the year 2018. Those just decay out of the environment. And then we can see the total at the top there. Now, I've also added in the standard deviation around this average. So this is the average, actually, of 220 Monte Carlo runs that we did with our debris model, which took, I think, for this simulation, around about a month to run. I'll explain why it took a month in just a moment. But what we can take away from this is actually, over this 200-year period, the population looks like it's only growing linearly. So there's a very, very slight growth in the population. And it looks like our space debris mitigation guidelines are doing a really, really good job of controlling the growth of the space debris population. But remember what I said about the atmosphere, and that the lifetimes of these objects can be really, really long. I've just done a 200-year simulation, but many objects in the environment will last much, much longer than that. So let's kind of just reframe the simulation now. So now what I'm showing you is that the time axis now, instead of going 200 years, now goes 1,000 years. I've just put the results that we had on it to start off with. And you can see the slight upward growth in that. But you might look at the number of new fragments. These are coming from collisions and say, actually, you know, the rate of growth is declining. That actually looks okay. But what happens if we continue the simulation? So I haven't changed anything, just run it for a bit longer. And actually what we see is this. What looked like this nice, benign growth of the population, you know, really, really slight growth in the population, suddenly turns into this exponential growth. And it's driven by, you know, if you look at the orange line, it's driven by new fragments, which are coming from collisions. So something that looked okay, based upon our United Nations space debris mitigation guidelines, is actually not. And it's exactly what we saw with the exponential growth model, this super exponential curve, which is what this is. And we see it with the more complex model as well. So both of these models, the most simple, the most complex, are giving us the same answer in terms of our expectations for the orbital debris population. And they're telling us that orbital debris population is growing in spite of our best efforts to try and control it. When we look at where that growth is occurring, this graph is showing the spatial densities, the change in the spatial density. So we've got the colder colors for the earlier on in the simulation period and the warmer colors for later on in the simulation period. We can see that the growth is occurring at the high altitudes where these objects are lasting in orbit for, you know, thousands of years. It's exactly what we would expect. And it's exactly what the complex model is telling us. So we kind of have to take a step back and understand, why is this happening? Well, the space debris problem is actually what we call a super wicked problem. It's a problem because all of our efforts to try and control it, the regulations that we imposed, that the organization that imposed those regulations are also the same organizations that promote the use of space. You can just look at organizations like the FCC, they have that kind of dual role. But it's also one of these problems that to us, it looks okay. It's something that is only going to happen in the future and far into the future at that. So, hey, we don't need to worry about it now. We just leave it for future generations to worry about. And that's really a classic super wicked kind of problem. It's exactly the same as climate change. We just don't think it's a problem for us now. And it's also distant in the sense that, you know, the orbital population is completely out of sight, out of mind. So we don't really worry about it either. Same thing is true with climate change. Climate change tends to, we think it affects people who are distant from us, you know, on the other side of the planet. So there's a huge amount of overlap between the problem of climate change and the problem of orbital debris. And obviously lessons can be learned in both senses, but it's primarily because they're both super wicked problems. Now, we could, of course, solve this problem easily. All we need to do is to stop launching or halve the number of launches that we make. Potentially that starts to solve the problem. But of course, that's not really fair. And there are people on around the Earth who would say that's not a good thing to do. You know, emerging space nations, in Africa, India, Asia, South America, they're just kind of getting started in space. And if all of a sudden we say, hey, you know what, we can't actually let you fly your missions because of the space debris problem, then it's not fair, especially if we're the countries who've actually had the best use of space since the beginning of the space age. So not really a good solution. So we're left with this idea that actually what we have to do is if we want to continue to use space, we have to adopt a principle that is we're already seeing here on Earth, which is leave no trace. You know, so when you go into the mountains, when you go into national parks and so on, it's this idea that actually you take the litter home, that you clean up after a campfire, you leave no trace that you were there. And we have to take the same principle into the orbital environment if we're going to tackle the space debris problem. And that is actually really, really difficult to do. Nearly every space mission creates some kind of orbital debris, which is why we're in the problem that we're in. So we have to really try and get a grip. But the other problem is it's not sufficient. Even if we were to do this, take this leave no trace principle from now on, we're still left with the legacy of the last 60 plus years of the use of space. Lots of derelicts already in the orbital environment. So we also have to go into space environment and we have to clean it up. We have to remove the objects that are there. And in particular, we have to remove the objects that are large, that represent a substantial collision risks, because those are the things that will sustain the orbital debris population. So I'm kind of leave you with this idea, and I understand that it's actually quite a negative idea, that actually the this legacy of space activity we have has left the orbital environment in quite a dire situation. That you know, we're on this kind of exponential path, and that there's nothing that seemingly that we can do about it. But the good news is, of course, is that we are already starting to do something about it. We've got missions such as the ELSA-D mission from Astroscale, Clear Space One mission that's coming up in a few years. We've got in-orbit servicing that's happening. You know, and I've also got this point, we can take steps to solve this problem. So I kind of look at this idea that there's a storm coming, this prediction that I've been talking about, and actually just changed my mind. There are still things that we can do. There are still things that we can do to solve the space debris problem. And you know, you're the generation that are going to be required to do this. And unfortunately, you know, we have to pass the baton on to you. But I believe that you know you have the skills to solve this particular problem. So I'll leave you with that, perhaps slightly more positive thought. Very happy to take any questions. So thanks very much for listening.
Thank you so much. That was great. We do have a couple questions from folks. I'm just going to stop your screen sharing real quick. So the first question we have is, do you also study debris beyond Earth orbit, such as lunar orbit or even on the lunar surface?
So I don't personally study that, but there have been studies looking at debris around Lagrange points, for example, because we obviously are making use of those for observing the sun and other missions, and those spacecraft typically remain there. So there is an issue about orbital debris around the moon. There's no atmosphere there, of course, so there's no mechanism to remove it other than the gravitational perturbations that the moon has. And of course, if we want to put any kind of civilization on the moon, then orbital debris will be an issue because there's nothing to stop it from impacting the surface. So I'm pretty sure that would be a really interesting topic of research for the future, especially with you know missions like Artemis and so on.
Awesome. The next question, is there any agency that actually has the kind of power to regulate the orbital region by treaty or otherwise, or is it completely up to individual nations to decide for themselves?
That's a really good question. So, I mean, there is a treaty. It's the Outer Space Treaty that was produced in 1967. And that was, you know, something that was worked on at the United Nations. So it has lots of signatures from around the world. Not every state has signed it, but many have. But the debris mitigation guidelines that I mentioned, not really part of that. They're a way to try and achieve the aim of the Outer Space Treaty, which is not to contaminate space and to ensure that it's there to be used by all of humanity. So the space debris guidelines are actually enforced at a local level, national level, and the ones that, and the way in which the guidelines are enforced is different for each member state. So, you know, I can design a space mission and I can choose to launch it from a country that doesn't regulate in the same way that perhaps the US regulates or the UK regulates. And that's a problem. And I think that's something we do need to address somehow. But it's political, it's legal and technical, and it's a really difficult problem to solve.
Awesome. We have one more question. In terms of exponential growth equations, how well can you capture the uncertainty of large sudden increases from impact on large objects like rocket stages?
Yeah, again, another really good question. So that aspect is captured in the exponential model in the sense that you see this smooth growth because we are able to deal with fractional parts of objects. When we look at the complicated model, the damage model, then what we do see these sudden spikes upwards, but they average out when we do the you know lots of Monte Carlo runs. So you see these kind of smooth curves. So we do see it in our simulations, these steps up. And you would get in the environment a sudden increase in the collision risk in that in the vicinity where the debris cloud gets formed. And that does represent a problem. But when we do the modeling, it kind of all gets smoothed out a little bit. So we see the trends that emerge. So we can see that it's exponential rather than having these kind of spiky graphs that we get. So the understanding we get from the simple model is still valid, but in reality, we see it kind of occurring in a slightly different way.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you for that great lecture. Just so everyone knows, our next speaker is Andrew Greenberg, who'll be having a lunch and learn about the ORSAP project. So go grab some food and listen in. His link will be posted in the chat.